Matthew 8:29. What have we to do with thee? Willingly would they, by this word, drive him far from them. But when they see that they are held under restraint, and that it is in vain for them to decline his authority, they complain that they are tormented before the time, and likewise mingle entreaty. Thus we see that the devils breathe nothing but rebellion against God, and yet, with all their swelling pride, they are crushed and fall in a moment, for their malice and obstinacy, which is never subdued, ceases not to struggle against the government of God, and yet it is compelled to yield. Christ does not openly reject, as he did on other occasions, the confession of the devil, and the reason appears to be, that their enmity towards him was so manifest, as to remove every opportunity of unfavorable or calumnious imputation. Besides, Christ paid regard to the spectators. Accordingly, when malicious and wicked men were present, he was more eager to repress calumnies, and more inclined to put a severe restraint on devils. On the present occasion, it was quite enough that the devils, while they were offering a prayer and entreaty, raged and stormed against him. Hast thou come hither before the time to torment us? Some explain this kind of torment as consisting in their being compelled to set at absolute liberty the man whom they possessed. Others understand it as referring to the last day of judgment. My view of it is, that they trembled in the presence of their judge, while they thought of their punishment, for, though Christ said nothing, a bad conscience told them what they deserved. As criminals, when they come to the judgment seat, expect their punishment, so devils and all wicked men must tremble at the sight of God, as truly as if they already experienced hell, the unquenchable fire, and the torments that await them. Now, the devils knew that Christ was the judge of the world, and therefore we need not wonder that the sight of him impressed them with dread of immediate torment. Were they acquainted with the day of the last judgment? This question, which some have proposed, is uncalled for. What, then, is the meaning of the phrase, before the time? It means that the reprobate never reckon that the time for punishing them is fully come, for they would willingly delay it from day to day. Any measure of delay, which the Lord is pleased to allow them, is counted gain, and thus by subterfuges they endeavor to avoid his sentence, though the attempt is to no purpose. Mark 5:9. My name is Legion. The devil was compelled by Christ to pronounce this word, that he might more fully display the greatness and excellence of his grace. There must have been good reasons why this man should have endured so severe a punishment as to have an army of devils, so to speak, dwelling within him. What compassion then was it, to rescue from so many deaths a man who was more than 1,000 times ruined? It was a magnificent display of the power of Christ, that by his voice not one devil, but a great multitude of devils, were suddenly driven out. Legion denotes here not a definite number of men, but nearly a great multitude. Hence it is evident what a wretched creature man is, when he is deprived of the divine protection. Every man is not only exposed to a single devil, but becomes the retreat of vast numbers. This passage refutes also the common error, which has been borrowed by Jews and Christians from the heathens, that every man is attacked by his own particular devil. On the contrary, Scripture plainly declares, that, just as it pleases God, one devil is sometimes sent to punish a whole nation, and at other times many devils are permitted to punish one man, as, on the other hand, one angel sometimes protects a whole nation, and every man has many angels to act as his guardians. There is the greater necessity for keeping diligent watch, lest so great a multitude of enemies should take us by surprise. Mark 5:10. And entreated him earnestly. Luke says, they requested that they might not be sent into the deep. Some explain these words to mean that they wished to avoid uninhabited places. I rather view it as referring to their rage for doing mischief. As the devils have no other object than to prowl among men, like lions in search of prey, they are grieved at being plunged into the deep, where they will have no opportunity of injuring and ruining men. That this is the true meaning may be inferred from the words of Mark, who says that they requested that they might not be compelled to go out of the country. In a word, they manifest their disposition to be such, that there is nothing which they more eagerly desire than the destruction of mankind. Matthew 8:31. Permit us to depart into the herd of swine. Some conjecture that they wish to attack the swine, because they are filled with enmity to all God's creatures. I do admit it to be true, that they are entirely bent on confounding and overthrowing the whole order of nature which God has appointed. But it is certain that they had a more remote object in view, to excite the inhabitants of that country to curse God on account of the loss of the swine. When the devil thunders against Job's house, he does so not from any hatred he bears to timber or stones, but in order that the good man, through impatience at suffering loss, may break out against God. Again, when Christ consents, he does not listen to their prayers, but chooses to try in this manner what sort of people the Gadarenes are. Perhaps, too, it is to punish their crimes that he grants to the devil so much power over their swine. While the reason of it is not known by us with certainty, it is proper for us to behold with reverence and to adore with devout humility the hidden judgment of God. This passage shows also the foolish trifling of some irreligious men, who imagine that the devils are not actually existing spirits, but merely the depraved affections of men, for how could covetousness, ambition, cruelty, and deceit, enter into the swine? Let us learn also, that unclean spirits, as they are devoted to destruction, are the enemies of mankind, so that they plunge all whom they can into the same destruction with themselves. Mark 5:15. And they come to Jesus. We have here a striking proof that not all who perceive the hand of God profit as they ought to do by yielding themselves to Him in sincere godliness. Having seen the miracle, the Gadarenes were afraid, because the majesty of God shone brightly in Christ. So far they did right, but now that they send Him out of their territories, what could have been done worse than this? They too were scattered, and here is a shepherd to collect them, or rather, it is God who stretches out His arms, through His Son, to embrace and carry to heaven those who were overwhelmed by the darkness of death. They choose rather to be deprived of the salvation which is offered to them, than to endure any longer the presence of Christ. The apparent ground of their offense is the loss of the swine, but Luke assigns a loftier cause, that they were seized with a great fear, 556. And certainly, if they had been exasperated by the loss which they sustained, they would not have requested Him, but would rudely have driven Him out. They honor Him as God's minister, and yet are so struck with dread as to desire that He will go to a distance from them. Thus we see that they were not at all moved by a sense of the divine grace. And indeed, though all wicked men adore God, and bestow great pains on appeasing Him, yet if they had their choice, they would withdraw to the greatest possible distance from Him, for His face is terrible, so long as they contemplate Him as a judge, and not as a father. The consequence is, that the gospel, which is more delightful than anything that can be conceived, is everywhere considered to be so dismal and severe, that a good part of the world would wish that it were buried. And yet it is true that their fear was partly occasioned by their loss. Thus at the present day, so long as men believe that the kingdom of God is opposed to their interest, either of a public or private nature, they are prepossessed by a depraved and carnal fear, and have no relish for His grace. Accordingly, when He comes, they think that God does not regard them with favor, but rather with anger, and, so far as lies in their power, they send Him to another place. It is a mark of shameful insensibility in those men, that the loss of their swine gives them more alarm than the salvation of their soul would give them joy. Luke 8:38. And the men requested the Gadarenes cannot endure to have Christ among them, but he who has been delivered from the devil is desirous to leave his own country and follow Him. Hence we learn how wide is the difference between the knowledge of the goodness, and the knowledge of the power, of God. Power strikes men with terror, makes them fly from the presence of God, and drives them to a distance from Him, but goodness draws them gently, and makes them feel that nothing is more desirable than to be united to God. Why Christ refuses to have this man as one of His followers we cannot determine with certainty, if it was not that He expected the man to make himself more extensively useful by communicating to his Gentile countrymen the remarkable and extraordinary act of kindness which he had received, And this he actually did, as we are assured by Mark and Luke.